So I think by now I don't need to convince anyone that moving to the cloud is useful and important. And I think a challenge that many, many enterprises face today is how to do it. And usually we have like this huge infrastructure and servers and thousands of different applications. And in order to understand how to move them, we need to identify what do we want to move first, what is going to be the most useful, what is going to minimize our disruption to our current application, and most importantly, how can we move there as fast as possible. So in general, we talk about three different steps in migration. One is assessment, understanding what are the difficulties that we are going to face when we are going to migrate. What is the expected downtime? What should we communicate to our users? Then we do the actual migration. After we finish migrating, we tune our applications to fit better to the cloud, to fit better to the profile that we are now running on GCP. So usually what we, in the first step, we even decide what apps do we need to move and what apps can we even move, because sometimes not everything can be just lifted and shifted, and we're going to talk about this in a minute. But what dependencies do we have? Is everything going to be shifted as is, or are we going to modernize something? What is important for our application? Do we have some specific performance requirements that might not be met when we're in the cloud? Do we have some specific latency requirements? And then essentially that step will tell us what is the right path to the cloud. And we have, I think in terms of tooling, this is probably the part that is the most difficult today. This is the part where there is the least amount of tooling. We are going to show one partner that have built an assessment tool for migrating a specific type of applications. But I think that in general, this is the place where we rely on knowledge and we rely on either the engineers inside the company or on our own PSO organization to understand what the impact is going to be for migration. And in general, we have different migration types, and we need to understand how exactly we are going to migrate. I think probably the best way to migrate is the first one, to retire the application. I mean, if we don't need it anymore, let's just shut it down, and that's it. Migration is done. Unfortunately, most applications, we don't follow this pattern, and we actually need to be more complex. I guess if we can also replace it with some new vendor or something already in the cloud, some SaaS vendor, that's also pretty easy. We first move to that vendor, and then we retire. But then when we actually need to move it, then we have a lot of options. I guess the least disruptive option, but also usually the least useful, is just to rehost it. We take our servers as is, and we migrate those servers into the cloud. About 6 months ago, Google acquired the Velostrata, which is a company that does VM migration, and there are other Google partners that does that as well. Then we start getting into the realm of actually changing something in the application when moving to the cloud. And again, this is usually more disruptive, but also more useful. So we have we can revise our application, so maybe just move the VMs, but also maybe containerize some of them to be able to run them on some container engine. So just a little bit of change. Or we can actually refactor. So change our application to different modules. Some modules actually move to new stuff. Let's say we take our database, which we're going to talk about in length in this talk, and move it to Cloud SQL. And then we take the other part of our application and just move the VM as is. And then we're going to the things that usually are harder to do, which is complete rebuild or complete rewrite of the application to fit the cloud. I think where we are going to focus in this talk is on the refactor area, where we want to take some of our footprint and move it into cloud-native tools, mostly the databases. And then some of our footprint we'll probably just keep as is, and we'll just talk to the same in the same API, the same way, but to new databases that exist in the cloud. And then once we're done, of course, we're going to optimize. We're going to try to optimize for cost, going to optimize for speed, going to optimize for latency. That's only once we're done moving. And with GCP, we can actually, we have built and spent a lot of time and effort in order to build migrations better. And one is, of course, the fundamentally making the cloud itself better, making it scale, the network performance, and the ability to actually transfer data at great speed, the service level on the SLOs of GCP. And then the migration capabilities itself, which are migration features, migration tools, and migration partners. And eventually, you're not alone in this. We have a very good PSO organization and support that will help you throughout the process. And as I mentioned, usually during the assessment phase and the pre-migration step is where the organization is currently most important compared to the tooling that exists today. But of course, it's also very useful in the migration itself and then in the tuning, because those are people that actually know what's best and what best tool to use and how to use them in the cloud. So let's talk about different migration types. One thing that actually works very well today in Google Cloud is we have the cloud compatible of the on-premise stuff. For Cloud SQL works both for MySQL and Postgres. We have memory store for Redis, which is API compatible to Redis. And Bigtable and HBase are also API compatible. So if those are the dependencies of your application, refactoring should be pretty easy, as you will not need to change any APIs, you will not need to change any drivers, and your application should just work as is exactly the same way it works against the on-premise databases. So usually a very common migration path, and the one that we are going to extensively cover in this session, is to move the databases themselves to Cloud SQL or to memory store, and then move the application using probably VM migration, and then you don't need to change anything in the application itself or in the drivers. And then I would say maybe the more interesting but also not as easy migration path is when we want to modernize database. And this happens usually for one of maybe two reasons. One reason is we need more scale. We need better. Our MySQL instance can no longer fit the bill of what we need, or our Postgres instance is no longer scalable enough for our data needs. And that's why we've built Spanner. And Spanner is a low latency, very high availability, and scalable database system in the cloud. And it's not API compatible with MySQL, not API compatible with Postgres, but very, very similar. So usually most of the thing that you're able to do with MySQL and Postgres, most of your queries will just shift as is. There will be some work on understanding what's not exactly compatible and then moving that. The other reason is I have tools that are, I would say, I'm using them for many years now and I want to modernize them. So I'm using Oracle, for example, I'm using Cassandra, and I want to move either to Cloud SQL, to Cloud Bigtable. Usually, the main reason we see moving Oracle to Postgres in the cloud is to reduce costs. And then if we, the Cassandra migration that we see is just sometimes at a certain size, it is becoming very difficult to manage your own Cassandra cluster, to understand the issues, the production issues that are happening. And then moving to Bigtable usually takes away a lot of this load. We do have, for this, again, the tooling here are not as advanced. But we do have a lot of guidelines, a lot of experience, a lot of migration guidelines that will help you do this and take you step by step throughout that process of doing the heterogeneous database migration. So as some of you may have heard, Aluma acquired Google Cloud. This actually have become official last week. Aluma has been focused on data migration from the beginning 5 years ago, and inside Google, myself and the entire Aluma team is going to be focused on delivering a great database migration experience and then expanding the current capabilities of database migrations. And the other side is we don't think that we can provide everything ourselves, and we don't think that you can do everything ourselves. And that's why we've partnered with great companies like Stream, and the other tool that I'm going to show today is MIGVisor by Niatek, which helps with that process as well. So with the partner ecosystem and the in-house tooling that we've built and your own engineers, the goal is to make that migration as easy as possible. We have some customer examples. So one example is Evernote. Evernote have moved over 5 billion user notes into GCP in 2 months, a little bit over 2 months. Pantheon migrated 200,000 websites, which they host, from on-prem to MySQL, just moving the MySQL instance from on-prem to GCP in a couple of weeks. And then Optiva moved from Oracle to Spanner, saw about 10x increase in database performance. So those doing those migrations are actually useful. And usually, you know, you probably ask yourself, why would I enter that migration, that painful migration project that might take me a long time, might take me a long effort? Usually it's worth it. Usually, sometimes it's not as painful as you think it's going to be. Sometimes the existing tools can actually make it easier, and you can get it done in 2 weeks or in a month. And sometimes just the performance impact, the cost impact is so great that it's just worth it again as well. So with that, let's try and focus a little bit on migration into Cloud SQL and how to lift and shift your application, hopefully with minimal downtime and minimal effort. In general, the recommendation is, of course, whenever possible, try and take the simple approach. And the simple approach is just a downtime migration. So I have, let's say I'm doing a like-to-like, a homogeneous migration. I have a MySQL instance on-prem. I want to move it to the same instance in the cloud. Usually, I would tell my users, hey, there's going to be a downtime. The downtime, of course, depends on the database size. Stop writing to the source database. Perform a dump, like a MySQL dump or whatever, to move the schema and the data itself. And in the MySQL dump itself, we can also move triggers. We can move anything that we need. Spin up a new instance in the cloud. Load the data to the instance in the cloud. Switch the DNS or the direction to that server. And that's it. We're done. We re-enable writes. We re-enable all of the clients to write to the database. And that's very simple. Unfortunately, it's not always possible to take downtime. It's not always, and that can be from one of two reasons. One reason can be the database is just too big, so the downtime will be too long. The other is that it's business critical application. We won't be able to take downtime. One way, again, is to try and make some optimization to reduce the downtime. And actually, we have a lot of experience with it. We have a lot of, like, these are some real life great tips to reduce the downtime when doing the migrations. So one is when importing the data, disable all foreign keys, all secondary keys, because that way the database will not validate against them. So there is no need to actually do that validation because you already know you're moving the entire data set. And then when you import data, also import it and dump it, of course, in the order of the primary key. That usually makes import, that can have very, very significant impact on the import time. In terms of what are we choosing to import into, we want to make sure that, I mean, if we can have the available RAM larger than the data set, it means that the import time will be much faster. Using SD storage or high IOPS also greatly reduces downtime, increases migration performance. And then during the import process itself, of course, we're looking at how fast the storage grows. How fast is the, do we have any read operation? Do we have paging that's happening? And understand why import is taking some time and also how to reduce it. So this is all fine. These are all great and great tips, but still not good enough oftentimes. Like oftentimes, still, we cannot take the downtime, or the downtime will still be too long. And usually what, you know, if you have a one terabyte or several terabyte MySQL instance, you just cannot take the downtime. Or if you have a business critical application that keeps writing and need to keep writing, you cannot take the downtime as well. I'll go back to what we can do after import, but that's why we have an option of minimizing the downtime when migrating. So this is essentially zero downtime. And this is already available for MySQL to MySQL migration in your GCP instance. I mean, you can just click. I'm not sure if you ever seen this button that says migrate data. But this will actually do the migration with very low downtime or zero downtime. And the way it's done is it will, we have our application. It's still reading against the existing database. What that process is doing is that process starts a new instance, start replication, so like bin log replication running between your source on-prem and the database in the cloud, as if it was another of the slaves of the, as if it was a database slave. At some point, the data between the source and the target matches, and then we can pause writes, and then we can really have minimal downtime, maybe for a minute or for a few minutes, pause writes to the existing instance, move it to the new instance, and then resume. And because we had replication running, the data will be exactly the same. So we can actually move with minimal downtime. And from our experience, what we've seen is that minimal downtime migration are sometimes the make or break of, will I ever migrate my application to the cloud? Will I ever migrate my database to the cloud? So for the MySQL to MySQL use case, that option is already available. We'll go in the, we'll show it real quick. So let's say I have a data source. I'm pointing myself to the IP address, username, password of the source database. I'm choosing the instance type of what I'm going to migrate. And again, best to choose according to the TIFF that we've shown earlier. And I'm pointing it to a dump file. So let's say I ran MySQL dump at some point in the near past. I'm pointing, and I put it in a GCS. I'm pointing it to a dump file. I'm creating a replica. And after a few minutes, that replica will be created. And we'll have its own IP. And once the replica is created, we can actually start the replication. All you need to do in your source database is give permission. Once you've given permission to the database to connect as slave, you'll see the replica starts creating. So in that case, it's a read replica that's being created. And you can start monitoring the CPU, the utilization, the storage. And you can actually see, this is a fast forward. It was a very big database. It took about 30 minutes to migrate. This is a fast forward for 2 minutes. But you see the storage climbing up, and then the latency is being measured. The latency essentially tells you what's the difference between my current replica and the original server in terms of how far am I behind. So at the beginning, you'll see it growing. At that point, it was 30 minutes. At some point, that replication is done. And we are catching up on the bin log. Once we've read all of the bin logs from the source, we would actually see the latency going down to zero. At that point, you can click, you know what you've seen there, which was promote replica. Once we promote replica, we stop write to the source database. We're not writing anymore. We click promote replica. As you've seen, that process takes about 30 seconds. Which means it's no longer replicating. It's now the primary server. And once it's the primary server and it is promoted, we can actually start the writes from the application directly to that replica. And that's it. We're done. We had a minimal downtime migration between MySQL and MySQL. If we can go back to the deck. Yeah. Oh. Great. So after the import itself, I'm backing up a little bit here. Essentially, once we import it, once our application starts writing, we start to tune it. We are monitoring the performance. We see, do we have too many writes? Do we have too many reads? Once the application is actually running, we can add indexes to improve the performance. We can maybe change the instance type if we need more CPU or if we need more memory. We can turn on binary logging if we want to create our own replica. Now we can. We are, again, have a MySQL instance in the cloud. We can have a replica. We can have a read replica. We can turn on binary logging on our Cloud SQL instance. And essentially we're ready to go. We have our application running against database in the cloud. At this point, we can keep running our application VMs on-prem. We can take the application VMs and migrate them into the cloud as well to have a full, the entire application in the cloud. So this was for homogeneous MySQL to MySQL migration. That's great. What happens if we want to do a more complex migration? Let's say we want to migrate Postgres, Oracle to Postgres. So we have a big Oracle instance on-prem, and we want to modernize our application. We want to move to Postgres in the cloud. So here, actually, assessment is very important. And this this tool is a tool by Niatech called MIGVisor. And it provides you with information how difficult will it be to migrate your Oracle instance into Postgres. So you would choose a source, you would choose a target. In that case, I've chosen Oracle to Postgres. And I have here 5 or 6 databases. Now, what's nice about this tool, all it does is it will query the Oracle metadata. It will just run a bunch of like a couple thousand queries on the Oracle metadata, understand the current usage, understand, are you using a very specific Oracle synonyms, for example, that doesn't exist on Cloud SQL? What do we need to do about that? Are you using PL SQL extensively? And then you would need to convert that PL SQL. Eventually, each one of your databases will get a grade, a score, of how complex will it be to migrate that database, which is that bar chart that you can see here. So the ones with the higher score are more complex migration. The ones with the lower score should be like should just migrate very easily because you're not using any specific or proprietary Oracle stuff. And you can actually even see why. So I guess resolution here is not good enough, but you can actually dive deeper and say, hey, this is very complex. Why is it so complex? And then you will see these are the features, the specific features that are being used by the which are not compatible with Postgres or will need some manual intervention in order to move to Postgres. And you can even see which users are using this feature. So you can say, hey, my CRM app, maybe I'm going to keep it on Oracle for now because it's using some very custom stuff that I cannot move. But my billing app, I might be able to move to Postgres. And then the last thing that it will do, it will also analyze if the Oracle usage is more of analytics or OLAP usage type, or is it OLTP transactional type. And if it's an analytics usage type, you might be better served with migrating that specific application or that specific usage into BigQuery and not into Postgres. So it will tell you, hey, this type of application is using mostly OLAP queries. Consider not moving to Postgres, but moving it to a data warehouse that's designed for analytics like BigQuery. And those applications are doing mostly OLTP or mostly transactional load. And then it's better to go to Postgres. So currently, Niatech and MIGVisor supports assessment of migrations from Oracle to Cloud SQL, Postgres, and MySQL. And coming soon by them is also migrations into Spanner. And with that, I want to call on Codin and Alok to show us a demo of the actual migration with Stream. So we finished the assessment. We decided that we want to do the migration. We want to move over our Oracle to Postgres. One way of doing it is to use Stream. So
thank you, Yair. Welcome, everybody. My name is Alok, and I'm from Stream. I sort of feel like the brain surgeon after the complexity has been 100, so I get into the picture and tell you how to do the heterogeneous migration from Oracle to Postgres. That's my demo today. What I'm going to do is just click to the next one. OK. Just want to make sure my clicker is working here. Just go to the next slide, Claudin. Sorry. All right, just a little bit before I get into the demo. So Stream is a next generation platform, and we focus on 3 different solution categories. The categories are cloud adoption, hybrid cloud data integration, and in-memory stream processing. Of course, the focus today is on cloud adoption, and I'm delighted to announce a partnership with Google on cloud adoption, especially in the area of database migration. So what I'm going to focus today is on the Oracle to Cloud SQL Postgres migration. And especially as Yair pointed out, that downtime is a big problem, especially for mission critical applications. So you might have a number of different applications from your CRM, billing, payments, core banking, et cetera. And these might not necessarily be able to take any kind of an outage, but you still want to actually move on to your initiatives for cloud modernization or for continuous operations. You might also have data on other clouds, and you wanted to synchronize that with newer applications that you're deploying on the Google Cloud. So those are all the benefits that you gain. Of course, the critical problem here is the downtime part. So let's get into the demo, and I'm going to actually show you how Stream helps you do that. So this, I'm going to just have Corin help me with the demo. And this is the landing page of the Stream product. There are three parts here. There's the dashboards piece. There's the apps. Apps are the pipelines. So you'll hear me interchangeably use apps and data pipelines. And then there's also you can actually preview your sources before you get started. So we're going to jump into the apps part of the demo. What you see here are pre-built pipelines. And remember, this is a zero downtime type of scenario I'm talking about. This has two critical phases. There's phase one, which is instantiation. So that's where you make a one-time copy of all of the data, which could be gigabytes, perhaps terabytes, or it could be lesser. And then followed by a catch-up or synchronization phase, which we achieve through some very specialized readers that help you catch up the source and the target. And ultimately, the two sides are going to be in sync. So let's step into the initialization phase. So this is a simple pipeline that shows a pipeline going from an on-premise Oracle database into a Cloud SQL Postgres database. The way this was built was using a flow designer by choosing a number of out-of-the-box components where you configure your sources, for example, and your targets. And you can also transform the data along the way because it may be interesting because the data formats might be different, or you may want to realign some of the data as you're going through. Let's step into the configuration of just the Oracle database. So here's where you configure all of the different properties. And it's pretty flexible in terms of how you want to move the data. On the cloud side, here's where you provide your service account, your connections into the Postgres SQL database. In this case, we are going to be actually moving two separate tables for the purposes of the demo. We're going to attempt to do a live migration of 1 million records of the line items table, as well as do some DML activity in phase two with the change data capture for the orders table. So let's go ahead and deploy the application. And Stream can run in the cloud or on-prem. It's up to you. It's pretty flexible. And as we deploy it, you kind of see that there's actually this is a deliberate mismatch that we introduced. You heard Yair talk about some of the assessment checks and so forth. So it's important before you actually do the migration that the sources and the target schemas, et cetera, sort of add up. They're compatible. There's no exceptions, et cetera. So here it did detect that there's one incompatible data type. So we'll go ahead and just skip this specific one. We have Corin has actually fixed this in another flow. So we're going to jump into that initial load flow. So let's go ahead and deploy that. And once we deploy it, it's ready to get started. We want to check, Corin, whether the tables are already empty. So in this case, in the line item table, you can see that the count is zero. And now we're going to go ahead and run the application. That's the one that actually goes to to your critical database, which is Oracle on-prem. Go ahead and you can run that, Corin. Start the application. We'll also preview the data along the way. So once you can see now the data is beginning to flow in. In this case, we have 1 million records in the line items table. And that sort of keeps going. And you can also monitor the application progress. You can see that so far we have 400,000 input. The output and input obviously are changing. So this is where a lot of the magic is happening. So things like batch optimization, things like parallelism, things like event guarantees, things like commit semantics, all of the stuff is taking place behind the scenes. So it will be transactionally consistent when you actually complete the migration. So now I think we're done. Why don't we take a look at the Postgres SQL database, make sure that, and there you go. So your 1 million records table was just moved pretty quickly. And so the performance is very impressive. With that, what I want to do is, remember, this could be gigabytes or terabytes of data. What we want to do is, during this time, all of the data that is actually changing in the database, so this is your actual activity, that is being moved using a technique called chain data capture. So Stream allows you to actually have a specialized reader. And in this case, let's step into that. So here's where the reader properties are. In the interest of time, we can go a little faster. Same configuration for the target, obviously. And in this case now, what we do is we take activity from the redo log of the Oracle database, and we are going to effectively replay that on the target side to catch them up, thereby avoiding any kind of an outage to the production database. So again, in this case, we have a mismatch here. It's more of a precision mismatch. In this case, I'll ignore it, because I already know that all my data values adhere to the target side schema. So go ahead and ignore that. And we want to actually go ahead and move the table here. Again, the preview option is selected. And let's go ahead and start it. Codin's going to generate some DML activity using a separate simulator. This is where you're going to see some inserts, updates, and deletes. And you can see that he's running a number of DML operations against the orders table. And then Stream, you can actually already see that now not only are we capturing the data, but also the metadata. So these are things from the Oracle database, like the transaction ID, the system commit number, all of the metadata, the table name, the operation type, insert, update, delete. You can filter on stuff like this. And then you can actually go finally log into the orders table and see that there's, in fact, data present in this table. This was empty beforehand. So this is sort of a combined technique of instantiation followed by chain data capture and application that allows you to, at your own leisure, move your on-prem database into the cloud database. You can actually go ahead and test both sides while the migration is ongoing. It may take you a day, a week, or potentially months, depending on the size of the database. But the key benefits are that there's no outage, and you can keep your operations continuous for your mission-critical applications.